Hello everyone, so in today's video we are going to be talking about tetracyclines. So free tetracyclines are crystalline amphoteric substances which are having actually low solubility. So they are not very soluble when they are in free state. But if we talk about their hydrochlorides, they are more soluble. And such solutions are acidic and fairly stable. And when tetracyclines form chelates with divalent metal ions, they interfere with their absorption and activity. So if we talk about the mechanism of action or antimicrobial activity of tetracycline, we need to discuss this diagram over here. So first of all, tetracyclines are broad-spectrum bacteriostatic antibiotics. Bacteriostatic means that they are going to stop the growth of the bacterium. They're not going to destroy the bacteria cell, but they are going to inhibit its growth by inhibiting protein synthesis. As we know, protein is essential for growth. So that's how it's going to work. So tetracycline enter microorganism in part by passive diffusion, and in part by energy-dependent processes of active transport. So there are two ways of tetracycline entering the cell. One is through passive transport, and the other one is energy-dependent process. As we know, it is one of the active transport mechanism. So what actually happens when a susceptible organism intake tetracycline intracellularly, what these tetracycline will do once inside the cell, they will actually bind to the 30S subunit of ribosome in the bacterium. Over there, it will go and block the binding site of amino acyl tRNA to the acceptor site on the mRNA ribosome complex. As we know, over here we have a complex that is called as mRNA ribosome complex because mRNA is being attached to the 30S subunit of ribosome, so it is a complex. So mRNA ribosome complex is being formed over here, and tetracycline is going to be attached to this position over here. At this position, it will what it will do is that it will block the binding of amino acyl tRNA over here. This is the charged tRNA which is coming to the acceptor site, so that there could be addition of amino acid to the growing peptide. But what will happen in the presence of the tetracycline, that it will not allow this charged tRNA to get attached to this acceptor site, and ultimately there will be no more addition of amino acid to the growing peptide. So this is how it's going to work. Tetracycline are active against many gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, including certain anaerobes. Rickettsia and chlamydia and mycoplasmas. For susceptible organisms, differences in clinical efficiency may be attributable to features of absorption, distribution, excretion of individual drugs. Tetracyclines can be effective against both gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, including some certain anaerobes. And if we talk about susceptible organisms specifically, difference in their clinical efficacy depends upon different factors. As we know, if a drug is going to be absorbed well in the GI tract, it is going to be more clinically effective. And if there is good distribution of the tetracycline, obviously it will be showing more clinical effects. Similarly, excretion. Tetracycline resistant strains may be susceptible to doxycycline, minocycline, and tetracycline, all of which are poor substrate for efflux pump, if that is the mechanism of resistance. So once there is a resistance developed against tetracycline, if that resistance is because of some efflux pumps, which are not allowing tetracycline to be in the cell, and they are just throwing it out of the cell so that there will be decrease in the concentration of tetracycline in the cell, and ultimately there will be no or very little effect of the tetracycline. So if that's the case of that's the mechanism of action of resistance, in that case there are certain other antibiotics which could be used for as a substitute, like doxycycline, minocycline, or tagicycline. All of these are actually poor substrate for efflux pumps, which means that they are not going to be thrown out of the cell of the bacterium by efflux pump. So these drugs can work if there is a resistance against tetracycline. Now, if we talk about this different scenarios under which resistance can be developed against tetracycline. So first of all, first and the most important resistant mechanism is impaired influx or increased efflux by active transport protein pumps. As we have talked previously, that tetracyclines enter microbes partly by passive diffusion and partly by active transport. So if there is certain mechanism in which there is decrease in the influx of tetracyclines, because tetracyclines are partly transferred into the cell by active transport, and if that mechanism is being impaired, there will be resistance, ultimately resistance against tetracycline. This could be one scenario, or the other scenario could be increased efflux by an active transport protein pump. So in the other scenario, he says that there could be formation of a protein pump which is actively working to throw tetracycline out of the cell, so that there could be less concentration of tetracycline in the cell. So second mechanism of resistance is ribosome protection due to production of proteins that interfere with tetracycline binding to ribosomes. So as we know, tetracycline go to the 30th subunit over here and attach to the acceptor site and block the binding of charged tRNA to the acceptor site, so that it could prevent the addition of amino acid to the growing peptide. So the second mechanism of resistance could work this way, that ribosome could be protected by certain proteins. In this case, that these proteins are actually interfering with the tetracycline binding to the ribosome. So there will be no more tetracycline binding to the ribosome, and ultimately there will be no more effect of the tetracycline. So these are proteins produced by bacterium for the protection of ribosome being attacked by tetracycline. And the third one is enzyme inactivation. In many other resistance mechanism, we have talked about enzyme inactivation, where there are certain enzymes being produced by the bacterium which destroy the structure of antibiotic, and ultimately that antibiotic is no more effective against bacterium. So the most important ones are first two, that is, those are efflux pump, production of efflux pump, and production of proteins for ribosomal protection. TET, that stand for tetracycline, and A stand for resistant determinants, tetracycline resistant determinants. So from A to E, there are different kind of efflux pumps. So these kind of pumps are efflux pumps expressing gram-negative species are resistant to the older tetracyclines. Gram-negative species which are having such efflux pumps or tetracyclines are resistant to such scenarios, and doxycycline and minocycline all are also resistant towards these efflux pumps. They are susceptible, however, to tetracycline. So those species which are producing such kind of efflux pumps, they can be susceptible to tetracycline, but not to tetracycline, doxycycline, or minocycline. So tetracycline is not actually a substrate for these pumps. Similarly, if we talk about other kind of efflux pump like tetracycline resistant determinant K, which is being produced by staphylococci, confers resistant to tetracycline but not to doxycycline, minocycline, or tetracycline, none of which are pump substrate. So only tetracycline is this pump substrate for this kind of efflux pump. So over here, only tetracycline will be thrown out of the cell, but not the doxycycline, minocycline, or tetracycline. So they can work effectively, but not the tetracycline. Now, if we talk about the next one, that is TETM, ribosomal protection protein expressed by gram-positive, produces resistance to tetracycline, doxycycline, and minocycline. So this resistant determinant actually produces ribosomal protection protein. There are certain proteins which are being produced by bacterium to protect the ribosome so that antibiotics could not get attached to the acceptor side of the mRNA and ribosome complex. So what will happen that this drug will ultimately be no longer effective. So only tetracycline is not effective against this kind of resistance mechanism because of the fact it is having a bulky group, that is tertiary butyl glyceryl amide substitute. It is a huge group and it causes steric hindrance. As we know, there is slow or decrease in the reaction process because of the bulky group being attached to it. So tetracycline will not be affected by this kind of resistant mechanism, but all of others will not be effective or will not be showing any results because of this mechanism of resistance. Okay. So tetracycline is a substrate of the chromosomally encoded multi-drug efflux pump of Proteus species and Pseudomonas aeruginosa, accounting for their intrinsic resistance to all tetracycline, including tetracycline. So over here, although in above cases, tetracycline was not being affected by certain resistant mechanism, but there are some other resistant mechanism or flux pumps being produced by Proteus species or Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which are actually chromosomally encoded and they are multi-drug flux pump. Like those flux pump can actually control or can actually have substrate sites for different drugs. So different drugs can get attached to those efflux pumps and can be thrown out of the cell. And those efflux pumps are actually chromosomally encoded. So Proteus species and Pseudomonas aeruginosa are having such efflux pumps and they can also make tetracycline ineffective in these conditions. And others as well, including all tetracyclines. So this is all about resistance mechanisms and mechanism of action of tetracyclines. So over here, if we discuss figure again, step in bacterial protein synthesis and target for several antibiotics. Okay, amino acids are being, okay, the 70S ribosomal mRNA complex is shown with its 50S and 30S subunits. In first step, the charged tRNA unit carrying amino acid 6 bind to the acceptor site on the 70S ribosome. Okay. The peptidyl tRNA at the donor site with amino acid 1 through 5, then bind to the growing amino acid chains to amino acid 6. Step 2. Okay. Step 1 is that this tRNA will come over here and then it will bind to the acceptor site on the 70S ribosome. And the next step is that peptidyl tRNA at the donor site, this is the donor site. This is the donor site with amino acid having 1 through 5, as we can see over here. 1 to 5 amino acids are being attached to this tRNA. Then bind to the growing amino acid chain to amino acid 6, peptide bond formation. Peptide bond formation occur over here, okay? And then the uncharged tRNA left at the donor site is released. Third step will be this one will get released because it is not having any charge over it. And then the new 6 amino acid chain with its tRNA transferred to the peptidyl site. Translocation, this process is called as translocation. This tRNA will move towards the next position. This is called as translocation. Over here, we have discussed on the tetracycline. So we can see over here, tetracycline is being attached to the 30S ribosomal subunit. So this is how it works. So guys, this was all about tetracycline for now. And in next video, we will be discussing about pharmacokinetics and clinical uses of tetracyclines. Till then, goodbye and subscribe to my channel and take care.